Good morning, happy Easter, happy Resurrection Day. We want to invite you to stand as we begin our time of worship celebrating our risen Savior.
Thank you. so glad that you're here with us this morning. We encourage you to pick up one of our bulletins. It's got lots of information about things going on in the church. And we would also ask that you fill out the Connect card on the side of the bulletin. Just tear that off, fill it out, and leave it on your pew. It lets us know that you were here this morning. It's also how you can share prayer requests with us, as well as update your information. Now, here's Destiny to tell you more about our youth envelope fundraiser that's going on right now.
Hi, everyone. My name is Destiny, and this is our youth envelope fundraiser. So basically, what you do is you come to the board, and you pick a card, and you would put $54 in here because you pick card 54. And then after you put the money in here, you go and hand it either to Robert or you put it in the offering box. If you have any questions about that, then the paper will decide to tell you what to do. But I encourage you to do this because in 5 weeks of good envelopes, there are Miss Julie's famous brownies and Miss June Bogla's cheesecakes and cocoons. So support the youth!
Join us in celebrating our local high school. We are having a teacher and faculty luncheon at South Spoosh. We need your help. Our menu will be soup, salad, sandwiches, and desserts. We also need volunteers to serve and transport food. Men and women are needed. It's really a fun day. Please sign up on the ministry wall.
We also have Vacation Bible School coming up this summer. There's a table out in the breezeway with all the information about VBS, how you can sign up to help out, as well as things that are needed as donations. So check out the VBS info in the breezeway. And while you're out there, check out our ministry wall as well. There's lots of information there about the different ministries in the church. Thank you again for being with us. Have a great morning of worship.
As our children's choir comes up to prepare to sing, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we just come before you, thanking you and praising you for what you have done. What we celebrate here this morning, we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ and what that means for us as believers, our freedom that is found in you. So, Father, we just celebrate and worship you this morning for who you are, and we pray that everything that we do, everything that we say, and everything that we sing would bring honor and glory to you and you alone. Amen.
you, children's choir. Let's give them another hand.
Months and it's a privilege to be able to work with them and worship with them. Let's go ahead and stand as we continue to worship this morning.
God sent His Son.
Elders' wives come forward for a time of prayer. So if you have any prayer needs or praises that you would like for them to pray with you this morning, we'll have some in the front as well as the back of the sanctuary to pray with you this morning.
Thank you.
Celebrate this morning that we do not serve a God that is buried and dead in the grave, but we serve a God who is alive, a God who is risen. And we praise you, Jesus, this morning for who you are, and we celebrate your resurrection. Amen. You may be seated.
He is risen. small words that brought the collective pace of humanity to an absolute standstill. He is risen. Three words that shattered prisons. Words that shook the earth's foundations. Words that transformed a sense of utter despair into cries of pure joy and ecstasy. Echoes of history's greatest triumph that still shape our reality. Even today, we're assaulted by constant distraction, countless sources waging war for our attention, yet three words pierce the noise. In our hunger for validation, our desperate pleas for love and attention, three words calm our anxiety. In a universe spinning at breakneck speed, its inhabitants locked in an existential crisis, three words proclaim the purpose of our existence. He is risen. Lay hold of this truth and embrace the peace within. Yesterday, fear reigned in our hearts. Yesterday, we sat in crippling darkness. Yesterday, we suffered abuse and all the accusations of a broken world. But today, our king, our healer, our defender is risen. And this reality doesn't merely accompany us on a meaningless journey. This changes everything. For you see, if he is risen, then all other pursuits become secondary. All of our failures become insignificant. All criticisms and condemnations become irrelevant. There is only his word, his mission, and his infinite, unconditional love for you. Because he is risen, we look to tomorrow. Tomorrow we will stop defining our worth through status and social media. Tomorrow we will together build an everlasting kingdom. Tomorrow and every day after, we will dance in the radiance of a redeeming savior who crushed death and set us free. There is nothing that Jesus cannot overcome. We know this because he lives. We know this because he is risen.
Good morning. Today we are very pleased to have with us a special guest from the Middle East. And this person from the Middle East actually met Jesus Christ face to face and was miraculously healed by him. And we have the privilege of inviting him here today to share his story with us.
This place is so beautiful. Strange candles are burning so brightly. Why, look at all of them. I love to see light. This bench upon which you are sitting, this is the color red, correct? I love the color red. And that is the most colorful robe I've ever seen in my life. This is wonderful. Why, just look at all of this. Oh, my friends, please forgive me. I still have not gotten over this amazing ability to see. For you see, until very recently, I was blind. I lived in total darkness. I did not know what anything looked like. You see, some people lose their sight from an eye disease or an accident. And then when they become blind, they can at least recall in their minds what a flower or a tree looked like. But not me. For I was born blind. I had never known what a tree looked like. I had never seen my mother's face, or a sunrise, or a sunset. All that I knew was complete and total darkness. And really, I had no hope of ever gaining my sight. For in the history of our people, stretching back thousands of years, it has never been known that anyone who was born blind received their sight. But then one day, all of that changed. Because I was once blind, but now I see. And that is why I'm here with you this morning to share with you the extraordinary way in which I came to see. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Joab. And being blind, I lived in Jerusalem with my parents, and I used to beg for alms every day by the temple gate. One day, I was sitting in my usual place by the temple gate, and I heard a group of men ask their teacher a question which, unfortunately, I had heard many people ask before. Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he should be born blind? I had heard that question so many times that I really did not pay too much attention to it. But this particular teacher answered in a way I had never heard before. Strangely enough, he said, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this has happened that the work of God might be displayed. I could not believe my ears. Here was a man who thought that my blindness was not a result of sin. And then he said something else which I will never forget. He said, while I am in the world, I am the light of the world. I did not understand what he meant by this until later. But then I sensed him kneeling right before me, and I heard him spit. I could tell he was doing something down there on the ground, and the next thing I knew, he was putting a moist, clayish substance upon my darkened eyes. Some people believe that a mixture of saliva and clay is a remedy for eye diseases, and so I was not insulted in the least by this kind gesture. In fact, I was touched by the fact that he wanted to. After he put the clay upon my eyes, he said, go and wash in the pool of Siloam. I could not see this man, but he spoke with such a quiet confidence and compassion that I felt impelled to do what he asked me to do. And so I made my way through the narrow streets and winding streets of Jerusalem until I came to the pool of Siloam. When I got there, I bent over and, cupping my hands, I dipped them into the cool water and splashed it into my eyes. At first, nothing happened. But then I began to splash more and more water into my eyes, and suddenly, something strangely different happened. Instead of the usual darkness which I was accustomed to, I saw a faint glimmering. Excitedly, I began to splash more and more water in my eyes. And as I did, it became brighter and brighter and more clear. Until suddenly, a sheer wave of joy swept upon me as I realized that I could see. With tears streaming down my face, I cried out as loudly as I could, I can see! I can see. Then I began running around, hugging everyone in sight, everyone I could find, and frantically picking up objects that I had never seen before. Rocks and leaves and sand. Then I stopped, and it occurred to me that I should go back to the temple and thank this man who had given me sight. And so I quickly ran back as fast as I could to the temple. And when I got there, he was gone. I asked a bystander if he knew who it was that had put clay upon my eyes. He said that his name was Jesus. Jesus. I vowed that I would find this man, Jesus, and thank him. My parents! So I dashed off to my house to tell my dear mother and my dear father about this wonderful miracle which had happened to me. And as I ran through the streets, my neighbors would stop whatever they were doing and stare at me in astonishment. Is that Joab, the blind man? What on earth has gotten into him? That is not Joab. No, Joab is blind. He cannot see. He cannot run like that. And as I would run by, I would say, yes, it's me, Joab. I can see. And children began running after me, as well as some curious adults. And by the time I got home, there was quite a crowd of people there to see what had happened. I'll never forget the look on my mother's face when she first saw me. At first she was frozen still. And she wrapped her arms around me and cried, oh, Joab, Joab! Then the crowd, in a frenzy, began to ask questions all at the same time. What has happened, Joab? Can you really see? Is it true? How did this happen? And on the questions went, and it caused such a stir that some people decided that they should take me to the Pharisees to see what they thought about all of this. The Pharisees, of course, over and over and over again, asked me the same questions which the crowd had asked me. And so I told them that a man called Jesus had put clay in my eyes. He told me to go and wash in the pool of Siloam, and I could see. It was as simple as that. As the Pharisees began to discuss the implications of this great miracle, they began arguing among themselves. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God. How could he be? Why, he broke the Sabbath. He made clay, didn't he? And that is work. A man from God would never work on the Sabbath. And yet other Pharisees would say, that may be true, but how could a sinner possibly perform so great a miracle as this? Not being able to decide about Jesus, they asked me what I thought about it. I thought about when it happened, and I said, well, this man has performed so great and so undeniable a miracle, he must be a prophet. As soon as I said that, the Pharisees became furious, and they called me an impostor. And so they brought my poor parents before them to see if indeed I was their son who was born blind. I felt sorry for my mother and father. They were terrified. Why were they afraid? Oh, they were afraid, my friends, because they did not want to get in trouble with the Pharisees over this man Jesus. You see, they hated Jesus. And they had let it be known that if anyone confessed Jesus as the Messiah, he would be excommunicated, cast out of the city. synagogue. My friends, excommunication is a dreadful thing. One cast out of the synagogue is treated as if he were a leper. He cannot go to the synagogue. He cannot associate at all with any other Jewish people. People are required to keep a distance of 3 cubits away from him. They cannot talk with him. They cannot eat or drink with him. They cannot even have a funeral for him if he dies. My friends, excommunication for a Jewish person is a living death. Meanwhile, the Pharisees, growing increasingly angry and hostile, said to me, "Glorify God for this great miracle, not this man, Jesus. He is a sinner." After a long pause, I said, "I do not know whether or not Jesus is a sinner. But one thing I do know, all my life, I was blind, but now I see." This greatly confounded the Pharisees, and they asked me to tell them again how I had gained my sight. But by this time, I was growing weary of their questions. Obviously, no matter what I said, they were not going to believe the truth. And so I said to them, you have heard my story. Why do you want to hear it again? What, do you want to become his disciples too?" I probably should not have said that. I looked over at my dear mother, and her face was so white, I thought she was going to faint. I looked over at the red-faced Pharisees, and they were so angry, I thought they were going to explode. Somehow, I had really hit a nerve. And so they began to hurl horrible insults at me. They said that I was a disciple of Jesus, but that they were disciples of Moses. And as for this man, Jesus, I did not even know where he came from. And so I said to them, "Well, here is an amazing thing, you learned Pharisees. You don't know where he comes from, and yet he has miraculously opened my eyes, a fact that you cannot deny. All of us know that God does not listen to sinners, but to the godly man who does his will. From the beginning of time, it has never been heard that anyone has restored the sight of a man born blind. I tell you, if this man were not from God, he could do nothing." In a blind rage, the Pharisees screamed at me, "How dare you attempt to teach us, you who are born entirely in sin?" Then they lunged at me and cast me out of the synagogue. I wandered around for hours in shock. What would I do? Where would I go? Down underneath a tree. After a long while, I felt a hand gently upon my shoulder. I looked up. Without him saying a word, I knew that it was Jesus. He said to me, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" Son of Man, that That is what the great prophet Daniel called the Messiah. Who is he, sir? Tell me that I may believe in him. Jesus looked right into my eyes. And he said, you have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you. All of a sudden, my eyes were open. And yet this time, it was my spiritual eyes as I realized that standing before me was Yeshua, Jesus, the Messiah, the Savior of our people. And so I fell at his feet and was barely able to whisper to him, Lord, I believe. And I worship you. Jesus had restored my physical sight. But far more importantly, he had restored my spiritual sight. Now, some of you, no doubt, are thinking, well, Joab, that is certainly a wonderful story. But is believing in Jesus really worth being excommunicated from your family and your people? You might as well ask me if putting clay on my eyes is worth receiving my sight. Yes! Yes, as it is worth it. Having seen who Jesus is, I can never disbelieve. You might as well ask me if I would like to go back and become a poor beggar again. No, having seen the light, I will never return to darkness. As the psalmist says, the Lord is my light. Whom shall I fear? My friends, thank you for letting me share my story with you. And I pray that every one of you will believe in Jesus as I believe in him. I pray that you will not have hard hearts like the Pharisees who, in spite of seeing a marvelous miracle, still refuse to believe. Believe in Jesus. Let him be the light of your life. Shalom.
Thank you, Joab, for sharing that amazing story with us. You know, the unprecedented miracle of giving a sight to a person who's been born blind should have been overwhelming, undeniable evidence of the fact that Jesus was the Christ, the Messiah, the long-awaited Messiah. It's hard to understand why the Pharisees, after witnessing such an incredible miracle, would so adamantly refuse to believe that Jesus was the Messiah. But you know, today we have an even greater miracle that overwhelmingly proves that Jesus is who he said he was. And that miracle is what we are celebrating today, the miracle of Easter Sunday, the miracle of the resurrection. After Jesus was crucified, let's think back. His followers were absolutely devastated. For them, seeing their master so horribly tortured and crucified, it was over. All of their faith and hope in Jesus was utterly destroyed. The disciples cowered in fear. They hid from the authorities, terrified that they would be arrested and executed for having followed Jesus. But that wasn't the end of the story. 3 days later, everything changed. Suddenly, these men were transformed. Their sadness turned to incredible joy. No longer afraid, they fearlessly and boldly went around telling everyone that Jesus was, in fact, the Son of the living God. What brought about the dramatic change? The resurrection. Nothing else can explain the radical transformation of the disciples. They had seen with and talked with and touched Jesus in his magnificent, risen from the grave body. And from that point on, they were never the same. And get this, Jesus didn't just appear to them, but to hundreds and hundreds of other people over a period of 40 days. His resurrection validated and affirmed as absolutely true everything he had taught them. Jesus really was and is the Son of God. The question for each of us this morning, each and every one of us, what is your response? Will you believe in Jesus? Will you trust that his death on the cross paid for all your sins? Will you accept him as your Lord and Savior? Or, like the hard-hearted Pharisees, will you reject him? The choice is yours to make. Would you all please bow your heads while we pray? If you would like to place your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can do that right now. Just tell God that you believe in Jesus, that he was real, and that his death paid for all your sins. Talk to God. Say something like this. Dear God, thank you for bringing me here this morning. Thank you for opening my eyes to see who Jesus really is. God, I know I've committed plenty of sins in my life, and I know that my sins have separated me from having a relationship with you. But thank you, God, for sending Jesus into this world. Thank you for loving me so much that you would let him die on the cross and take the punishment of all my sins unto himself. So, God, I don't understand everything, but I do believe that Jesus is your Son and that his death paid for my sins. Come into my life, Jesus. Be my Savior and my Lord. Amen. And you know what? If you prayed that prayer, congratulations. You just became a child of God. And if you prayed that prayer, I have to ask you if you would kindly do one more thing. You remember that Connect card you heard about earlier? On the back of it, the top line says, I receive Jesus Christ as my Savior today. And we want to know because we want to pray with you, and we want to give you encouragement and resources to help grow your faith. Thank you all for coming this morning. We hope you and your families have a happy Easter. And remember, he is risen. Amen.